know that my Redeemer lives, and that he shall stand at the latter day upon the earth. And though after my skin worms destroy this body, yet in my flesh shall I see God, whom I shall see for myself, and my eyes shall behold, and not another. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore will not we fear, though the earth be removed, and though the mountains be carried into the midst of the sea, though the waters thereof roar and be troubled, though the mountains shake with the swelling thereof. I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. I am now ready to be offered, and the time of my departure is at hand. I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith. Henceforth, there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day, and not to me only, but unto all them also that love his appearing. Good afternoon, my brothers and sisters.
On the behalf of
the relatives of Hortense,
we welcome you to this service of thanksgiving as we offer to God thanks for her life, her ministry, and service. And certainly on their behalf, we wish to extend thanks to you for your words of support, whether you sent cards or wreaths or in any other way. You sympathize with them during their time of sorrow. On their behalf, we say thanks to you. Let us pray. Our Father, we come to you in this time of sorrow, yet we are rejoicing for a life lived fully and lived well, one who touched others, and one who recognized your lordship not only of her own life, but of this world in which she is a part. You've chosen in your providence to take her away from the encumbrances of this life. We believe, Lord, that she is in a better place. We pray that you would comfort all those who mourn, and may this service of thanksgiving sensitize us in a profound way to the brevity and frailty of life, and grant that we would so order our steps that when we too reach this juncture, we can say with bold assurance, like the Apostle Paul, I have fought a good fight, I have finished my course, and I have kept the faith. Hear this, our prayer, in Jesus' name. Amen. Together we'll sing the first hymn, Blessed Assurance, Jesus is Mine. Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a fortress of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of his spirit, washed in his blood. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, perfect delight, visions of rapture now burst on my sight. Angels descend
spring from above, echoes of mercy, whispers of love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, all is at rest. I in my Savior am happy and blessed, watching and waiting, looking above, filled with his goodness, lost in his love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long.
Please sit. We'll now have the first Bible reading, and then this will be followed by a tribute by Patricia Gall.
A reading from the Word of God, taken from Psalm 46. God is a refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth should change, though the mountains shake in the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam, though the mountains tremble with its tumult. There is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy habitation of the Most High. God is in the midst of her. She shall not be moved. God will help her right early. The nations rage, the kingdoms totter. He utters his voice, the earth melts. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. Come, behold the works of the Lord, how he has wrought desolations in the earth. He makes wars cease to the end of the earth. He breaks the bow and shatters the spear. He burns the chariots with fire. Be still and know that I am God. I am exalted among the nations. I am exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
It is a great honor to give tribute to Hortense Elcock this afternoon. I merge my reflections with those of a few of her work colleagues. While these do not fully represent everyone who was close to her, and the experiences may differ, the sentiments are sure to be shared by all. Hortense was living proof of how truly wonderful a person can be. She was a strategic thinker, a perfectionist, and a visionary. She was brilliant, innovative, and creative, always readily available to give generously of her knowledge, expertise, and skills. She worked with passion, integrity, and energy, forever a good leader to the people in her charge, and accountable and reliable in the execution of her duties. She was humble, yet bold, often quiet, but fiery when the occasion merited it. She was also a good friend to many and a great colleague. There were times of sharing, times of praying together, and there were often exchanges about how the children were progressing. Hortense was very much appreciated for her kindness, which was often expressed. In the words of Albert Einstein, the value of a man should be seen in what he gives and not in what he is able to receive. Undoubtedly borrowed from the words of the Lord Jesus, who declared that it is more blessed to give than to receive. Hortense was certainly one who gave. She gave much to her work, friends, and family, and expected very little or nothing in return. Hortense was never one to shirk responsibility, and even when she was not feeling 100%, she would always insist that she would complete any task to be done. She was resilient and full of determination, and there was no way of persuading her to do differently. I recall one of my visits with Hortense in hospital. It was a short visit in hospital, but I recall one of my visits. She was very preoccupied with getting out of bed, which, according to her, the nurses were not allowing her to do. She pointed to a bed close to where she was and said with much passion, and I can't get that passion expressed here, but I'll try. "I just want to go from here to there." And she said this repeatedly. I gave some encouraging words about how it was better for her to remain in bed until it was safe to go for a walk. But from the look on her face, I could tell she was not convinced. In one ear, out the next. A day or so after the visit, I spoke with Russell and mentioned that his mom really wanted to get out of bed. His reply left me laughing and shaking my head. He said, "Mommy waited for the right moment, and then she was up and out of bed and taking that walk." Of course, the nurses were not too pleased. Hortense surely was. She had achieved her goal even in the face of great opposition. Her personal life was indeed personal, as Hortense was a very private woman. Her love for her husband, Wallace, and her devotion to her son, Russell, could, however, not be hid, as she always lovingly spoke of them. She was completely immersed in their love and the very close bond that they shared. Indeed, who can find a virtuous woman? For her price is far above rubies. Her children arise up and call her blessed. Her husband also, and he praiseth her. She enjoyed life to the fullest. The early morning walks with Wallace, her line dancing, her plants and mangoes, being able to attend church when she could, seeing her son grow into a very wonderful young man, and giving him full blessings as he started a new journey with his very lovely wife. Her life made a significant impact and was one that inspired emulation, exemplified brilliance, and burned brightly so that the paths of those around her were well lit. The character of the life Hortense lived can be summed up in a few words. Hortense was sincere, earnest, and loyal, a highly intelligent, vibrant individual with a unique friendliness and charming personality. Hortense was a genuinely warm and wonderful woman, always ready with a chuckle and a smile. She will be greatly missed. I thank God for her life and her unwavering faith, a faith that kept her positive and gave her the ongoing strength to complete the journey. The door of life was silently closed, and Hortense departed from us, but we will continue to celebrate the many times she brightened our lives. This ends the tribute for this afternoon, but the memories and testament of Hortense Elcock will forever be etched in our hearts and in our minds.
Thank you, ma'am. The musical selection, O Happy Day, is specially devoted to the memory of Hortense by her family. Following that, we'll have a video tribute by the family, and in the background of that tribute would be one of the numbers that Hortense loved. Following this, we'll also have the eulogy followed by the second reading. When I come back to you, it is to sing the hymn before the sermon in the sweet by and by.
Thank you. Natural beauty, you know. Yeah, no, I've never been someone shy until I've seen your eyes. Still, I had to try. Yeah, oh, yes, let me get my words right and then approach you. Woman, I'll treat you like a man is supposed to. You'll never have to cry. No. I know everyone can relate to when they find a special someone. And she's royal, yeah, so royal. And I want her in my life. I never knew anyone so one of a kind. No, the way she moves to her own. She has the qualities of a queen. She's a queen. Ooh, ooh. What a natural beauty. No need no makeup to be a cutie. She's a queen. She's a queen. And when they ask what a good woman's made of, she's not afraid and ashamed of who she is. She's royal, yeah, so royal. And I need her in my life. I never knew anyone so one of a kind until the night that I seen her eyes. Supreme. I can see it in her eyes, the way she smiles. Hey, yes, I and I know the king and queen crown, see I'm tied. So I'd never leave your side. Just stick with me through the trial times. Oh, and she says she no mine. Alright, I know good man is hard to find. And she can't about that giant line. That's why she has no ties at this time. Yeah. I know many men are trying, but she needs to be more than wine and dine. Because she's royal, yeah, so royal. And I want her in my life. So divine, the way she moves to her own beat. She has the qualities of a queen, so supreme. Ooh, ooh, what a natural beauty. No need no makeup to be a cutie. She's a queen, so supreme, yeah. And when they ask what a good woman's made of,
a pleasant good afternoon to everyone. Royalty, very much so. Yeah, very much so. Okay, so I'll talk a bit about Mommy's early life, and then I will share some of my own experiences of being raised by her and her very high standards. And then it will look at, you know, some of her passion, especially for dancing. So Mommy was born and spent most of her early life in Lucy, in the parish of Hanover in Jamaica. So at that time, she was growing up with her, mostly her cousins and her sisters, pretty much living in the same household. And at that time, her mother, Sybil Samuels, well, the late Sybil Samuels, migrated to England for a better life. So at that time, we had the whole concept of when parents would send for their children, right, when they had migrated. So in about around 1967 or thereabout, Sybil has sent for Mommy, and she continued her secondary education there. And then she went on to do the private secretary's diploma, and she then worked as a secretary at Birmingham Technical College in England. It was also during this time, in 1974, that she met Daddy, and then they got married in 75. So a few years later, she went to Wolverhampton Technical College, and then is when she did her diploma in education. She then taught at the Brooklyn Technical College, and then after a certain time, she migrated to Barbados with my father in 1985. She then worked in Sir Henry Ford's Law Chambers as a secretary, and also taught part-time at Queen's College, which is where he went to school, by the way. After this period is then when she started her career at the Barbados Community College. And she spent 33 years in the service. Growing up as a young man, I mean, people say you're your only child, you get spoiled. But one thing about Mommy, I never got what I wanted, but I got what I needed. I got what I needed in life. And what she did as well too, from a very early age, she exposed me to traveling a lot, which I think broadened my perspective on life from a very, very early age. So that's what she did as well. Like I said, she made sure that I had everything I needed, not what I wanted, right? So I recall an experience, because I know many of you know that, you know, I represented Barbados quite heavily in the sport of cycling. So back in 2014, Mommy asked me if I wanted to go to France. So then we went and I went to see the tour. So that was a big thing for me as a cyclist, right? So she took me to see the tour, and she took me traveling all around the world. And that's something I'm very grateful for. I think without that, you know, I won't have a pretty much broad perspective, and it widened my perception on how different cultures and, you know, how different people live and so on. So another experience I'll share, I went to Charles F. Broome, and I remember when I was head boy, I wasn't expecting it. But when they called my name for head boy, Mommy, I don't think I ever seen Mommy run that fast since. And she was running in heels, right? She was running in heels. And she ran so, it was like Usain Bolt. And she was so happy. She was so happy. I couldn't believe it. And she gave me a hug, and yeah, she was so happy. Any kind of achievement, Mommy was supposed to be so happy for it. I'll also share the CSC results as well. And when I got back my results slip, she told me, Russell, read it for me. So I said, principles of business one, principles of accounts one, history one, English A, English B one. She said, that's all I need to hear. That's all I need to hear. She only won't hear once. Right? So I was glad that she was pleased. So that was CSC. One of Mommy's last wishes, was to see me get my master's degree. And she did. She did. I attained my master's degree in September last year. Mommy was always a stickler for perfection. Right? Very high standards. Attention to detail. Right? I think most of you that know Mommy know that that's what she was about. She always instilled in me the importance of having a solid education. She always told me with education, you will get far in life. She always told me that. So over the years at BCC, she cared a lot about her students. I think anyone that was taught by mommy would know that she really cared. I remember, you know, coming home, and mommy would complain, I can't understand these students. Some of them have a bad attitude. You know, she don't like bad attitudes. Right? So yeah, that's an experience that I can recall. But you know, the bottom line is that she passed on a wealth of knowledge, not only to me, but everybody she taught. She also provided many employment opportunities for her students. And she really hit home the importance of being employed at an early age and establishing yourself in a professional career. One of her major achievements was when she wrote the Office Administration and Management Program at BCC. And it's true that is when she provided many employment opportunities for students. Mommy had a passion for dancing. It was a way of life. Like how cycling is a way of life for me. Dancing was a way of life for her. She had a lot of energy, a lot of enthusiasm, especially for line dancing. Right? No, I mean, she tried to get me to join, but that's one thing that she didn't pass on to me, her dancing skills. But again, the bottom line, she has such a positive impact on many. And whether it be through teaching, dancing, or her pleasant nature, mommy always used to smile. Always smiling. Don't care how she feel terrible, she's still smiling. Let this not be a day of sadness, but a day of celebration for a wonderful person, a wonderful life. She touched many lives. A perfectionist, a woman of high standards, and a giant of academic excellence. Thank you.
A reading from the Word of God, written in the book of Revelation, chapter 21, verse 1 to 7. And I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no sea. And I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned to meet her husband. And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them. And there shall be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away. And he said, And he that sat upon the throne said, behold, I make all things new. And he said unto me, write, for these words are true and faithful. And he said unto me, it is done. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. I will give unto him that is athirst of the fountain of the water of life freely. He that overcometh shall inherit all things, and I will be his God, and he shall be my son. The word of the Lord.
Please stand as we sing the hymn before the sermon. In the sweet by and by, as found on page 4. There's a land that is fairer than day, and by faith we can see it afar. For the Father waits over the way to prepare us a dwelling place there in the sweet by and by. We shall meet on that beautiful shore in the sweet by and by. We shall meet on that beautiful shore. We shall sing on that beautiful shore the melodious songs of the blessed, and our spirit shall sorrow no more, not a sigh for the blessing of rest in the sweet by and by. We shall meet on that beautiful shore in the sweet by and by. We shall meet on that beautiful shore. To our bountiful Father above, we will offer our tribute of praise.
For the glorious gift of his love,
and the blessings that hallow our days, in the sweet we shall meet on that beautiful shore in the sweet by and by. We shall meet on that beautiful shore. Today I wish to share with you on what I'm simply calling a woman of honor. A woman of honor. And I wish to draw your attention to the book of Acts, chapter 9, verse 36 through verse 42. But I'll just read one or two verses therein. Verse 36. Now there was at Joppa a certain disciple named Tabitha, which by interpretation is called Dorcas. This woman was full of good works and alms deed, which she did. The rest of the text suggests that she became sick. She died. They sent for Peter, who raised her from the dead. I'll make reference to the rest of the text during the course of the sermon. A woman of honor, let us pray. May the words of our mouth and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our redeemer. Amen. Please sit. A woman of honor. Recently we celebrated International Women's Day, on which emphasis was placed in part on the role of women in our society and the achievements they have made over the years. Indeed, brothers and sisters, we in Barbados have much to celebrate. Not only have our women contributed immensely to their respective families, but they have excelled in every area of endeavor, including education, business, sports, professions, politics, to name a few. And indeed, as you heard from the eulogy, and based on your own knowledge, Hortense certainly did her part, especially in the area of education. And if you would permit me just to mention a few, apart from the deceased, we cannot forget the outstanding contribution of persons like the late Dame Nita Barra, former Governor General of Barbados. We certainly cannot forget the contribution of our current president, the Most Honorable Dame Sandra Mason. We cannot forget the contribution of our former Deputy Prime Minister, Dame Billy Miller. Certainly the former president of the Senate, who was visually impaired and challenged. We cannot forget former Deputy Chiefs of Staff of the Barbados Defense Force. There was an excellent feature on them just on Monday evening on CBC. We certainly cannot forget our own Prime Minister, the Honorable May Motley, and countless others in our own society. Time will not permit us to mention them all, who in their own way, brothers and sisters, have been trendsetters, who have blazed the trail in their own respective endeavors, and who generally have left us a legacy as Barbadians of which we can be justly proud. Today, from the biblical perspective in this homegoing service, I wish to reflect on the life of a simple, ordinary woman who in her own right was an entrepreneur and community practitioner, and whose life and ministry touched many in her community, especially the poor and underprivileged, the poor and disenfranchised in one way or another. And so as we do so, we will equally reflect on the work, as I suggested earlier, the work, ministry, and labors of our departed friend and sister, Mrs. Hortense Elcock, who positively impacted many, especially in the educational arena, having served, as you have heard, at the Barbados Community College for over 33 years or so. And during that period, many students would have passed through her hands, or should I say, many students would have sat at her feet. And so as I do so, brothers and sisters, there are just three simple thoughts which I wish to leave with you for your own challenge, reflection, and edification. Notice firstly with me the fact that Dorcas, otherwise called Tabitha, was intentional in her service. She was intentional in her service. Verse 36 suggests that she did many good things, to use the language of the New International Version. She did many good things, and may I add that she was known in the city of Joppa and the surrounding areas as a doer of good things. Indeed, brothers and sisters, she lived up to her name. We are told that in ancient times, the gazelle or deer was regarded as a symbol of graceful beauty. And that's what her name meant, graceful beauty. And what is further significant to note is the fact that Dorcas gave generously to the poor and to the underprivileged. She utilized her skills of dressmaking and, should I add, fashion designing to cater to the needs of the widows and those who could not afford to pay her for her time and expertise. And so I wish to suggest to you, my brothers and sisters, that there are great lessons that we can learn from the simple but yet profound acts of charity and benevolence by Dorcas. Verse 36 suggests that not only did she do many good things, but she performed many acts of kindness as well. I believe that those acts of kindnesses probably took some other forms as well. I say to you that if ever we need a replication of this attribute in our own society, it is now. I have no doubt that the challenges of the past 2 years would have driven more people to the poverty line and even below. And certainly it has been a rough time economically, mentally, socially, and otherwise for many, many persons. Many persons, as you've heard, whether on television or in the news, social media, and the various discussions, many people have been displaced in one way or another. Many families have been displaced. Many businesses have been displaced. And yet, despite the displacement and the challenges here and there, we wish to thank God for the thoughtfulness and the generosity of all those precious souls like Dorcas, who continue to exercise their gift of giving and relatedly their gift of hospitality. I wish to remind you, brothers and sisters, that charity and benevolence and hospitality were all practices or features of life that were common in the early church. In fact, you recall in the same book of Acts, chapter 4 and 5 to be precise, mention is made of people selling their land and properties and giving the proceeds to the church for the sole purposes of taking care of the needs of the poor. In fact, what transpired in an early church certainly has been used sometimes as a model for one of the ideologies. We're told that people, in a sense, if I may paraphrase it, did not think that what they had was their own, but very often they brought things into a common pool and shared so that those who lacked would have been helped and ministered to. And I wish to suggest to you that when we give, we must do so not just seeing it as a marketing strategy or seeing it as a means of popularity, but we must give with the understanding that it is part of our Christian duty. It is part of our religious duty if you are not Christian. And I know that there are many different religions who give and give to those who are poor and who are needy. Jesus in Matthew chapter 25, verse 31 and following, seemed to suggest to us, brothers and sisters, that special consideration will be given on the day of judgment to those who meaningfully consider the plight of the poor and disenfranchised in our society. And I'll allow the text to speak for itself. In verse 34, he said, and I quote, "Then the king will say to those on the right, 'Come, you who are blessed by my Father, take your inheritance, the kingdom prepared for you since the creation of the world.'" Verse 35. "For I was hungry and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me to drink. I was a stranger, and you invited me in. Verse 36. I needed clothes, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you looked after me. I was in prison, and you came and visited me. Verse 37. Then the righteous will answer him, Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you something to drink? When did we see you a stranger and invite you in, or needing clothes and clothe you? When did we see you sick or in prison and go to visit you? Verse 40, the king will reply, truly I tell you, whatever you did for the least of these brothers and sisters of mine, you did for me. End of quote. A woman of honor. Dorcas indeed was a woman of honor. She was intentional in her service. But secondly, I wish to suggest to you that Dorcas was equally intense and impactful in her service. She was intense and impactful in her service. Verse 39. It would seem to me, brothers and sisters, that even at the point of death, the evidence related to the death of Dorcas spoke for itself. That passage suggests that all the widows, when Peter was summoned and he came and he went to the place where the body rested, the text suggested that all the widows stood round about Peter. And I believe that as they stood there, they proceeded to share their story concerning the generosity and the greatness of this woman, Dorcas. But not only did she stand, or did they stand round about Peter and share their story, but the text suggests that they were sobbing, they were crying. And maybe some were even, as Bajans would say, bawling. Because when you miss those you love and cherish, tears have a way of coming, and sometimes they come profusely and uncontrollably. Especially when you recall their goodness, when you recall their greatness, when you recall how they touch you in profound ways, sometimes you are moved to tears. But the verse finally suggested that they showed Peter, and this is the clincher. Not only did they stand by him and sobbed and cried, but the text said that they showed Peter, again using the language of the NIV, they showed him all the robes and other clothes that Dorcas had made while she was alive. She made them with her own hand. We don't have the time to develop all of these points. But what I wish to suggest to you today, and what I wish to entreat you with, is the fact that, like Dorcas, we must use every opportunity available to us to sow into the lives of others meaningfully by doing good, by doing something good, by being positive, by being proactive. And again, I would wish to allow Scripture to speak for itself, just as I quote about two or three additional passages. Galatians chapter 6, 9. Note what Paul said to the Galatians, and I quote, and let us not grow weary of doing good, for in due season we will reap if we do not give up. Sometimes persons would argue that the environment is not ripe for doing good. You may even be in a hostile environment, but yet the word challenges us not to respond in kind, but to respond in wholesome ways. Respond by giving. Respond by helping. Respond by doing good. And Paul says, don't be weary of doing good, for in due season, we will what? We will reap if we do not give up. But note what the writer Matthew said in Matthew 5:16. And again I quote, let your light shine before men or before others, so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father who is in heaven. End of quote. With just two more I want to leave with you. If we may go back to Paul again in Galatians 6:10, he said, So then, as we have opportunity, let us do good to everyone, and especially to those who are of the household of faith. Let me take a minute to reiterate a point that I made earlier. In these difficult times, the tendency may be for us to hoard or to say that I simply have enough for myself. But there's some interesting scenarios in Scripture. You remember that woman when the man of God went to her? She said, all that I have is a pot of oil in the house, just to make a few loaves of bread. Barely surviving. But in obedience to the man of God, she got all those containers that were in the house, and I believe she borrowed some. And you know this story quite well. That oil overflowed. She had more than she bargained for. So you don't lose when you give. When you give to God, when you give to others, you don't lose. It's like casting your bread on the water, knowing that that will return to you sometime, because the principle is still very sound, that what we sow, we reap. And if we do good, good will attend us. But not the last one, coming from the book of Hebrews, that unknown writer stated, and I quote, in Hebrews 13:16, do not neglect to do good and to share what you have, for such sacrifices are pleasing to God. I think that that is worth reading again. Do not neglect to do good and to share what you have, for such sacrifices are pleasing to God. May therefore remind you and admonish you to remember that we will be remembered by what we have done. There's an old song that we used to sing, only remembered, only remembered, only remembered by what we have done. And therefore, we must understand that life is not just about our own sense of comfort and our own sense of well-being. It is not just about our own measure of satisfaction and sustainability, but the satisfaction and sustenance and sustainability of others as well. What are we talking about today, a woman of honor, with special focus on Dorcas? I suggested to you that Dorcas was intentional in her service. I suggested to you that she was also She was also intense in her service. Thirdly, and finally, and quickly, I want you to note what I call some immediate and imminent aspects of vulnerability that impacted Dorcas even as she served. There were some immediate and imminent vulnerabilities that impacted her even as she served her family and served her community. The text suggests that Dorcas became sick. Is there anybody here who has never been sick? You know, you're not absorbed from sickness because you're doing good. Sickness, in part, is a result of the impact of sin in the world. Whether you're talking about moral evil or natural evil, that's a deeply philosophical and even theological subject. But the presence of evil is something that we have to deal with every single day. So Dorcas got sick, but the text also suggests that one day she died. I don't think that there is a person or a family in the world who would prefer their relatives, even though they're sick, to die. Although just recently I spoke to a colleague, he told me, look, my wife was so sick and I could not bear her friend. And even though she died, yet he felt that it was a relief because God delivered her from that sickness. So Dorcas became sick, but she died. And you know, there's a measure of finality from the pure human perspective. There's a measure of finality about death because it robs us of relationships. So you will not hear Hortense's voice again. You will not feel her touch. You will no longer be privy to that in-depth interaction. And the truth is, if you read the text both explicitly and implicitly, it is quite clear that Dorcas' death caused much displacement and sorrow in her community. And even though the text focused on the widows, I don't believe they were just widows, because widows had other relatives as well. She was known in her community for generosity, for benevolence. And therefore, when she died, a vacuum was created, a void was created. There was much displacement. And if I may take a leap in my presentation, I am glad though that based on the word of God, death for us who are in Christ, death for us who follow the dictates of God's word has no death, has no sting rather, has no power. And Paul beautifully and even poetically addressed this. He said to be absent from this body is to be what? Is to be present with the Lord. Death for us has no power, no sting. And I believe to some extent what Peter did in terms of raising Dorcas again from the dead was a type of what was to come in terms of Jesus, who died but rose again and became, as Paul said, the first fruits of them who slept. I believe that Jesus himself, in terms of his raising Lazarus from the dead, was a foreshadowing of what was to come when he rose again from the dead that third day. I am glad today that he lives and he lives forevermore. One song said, you ask me how I know he lives. He lives within my heart. We could spend the rest of the evening, brothers and sisters, talking about God, the existence of God, and how we can prove that he exists. The word simply says that he who comes to him must first believe that he exists and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. I do not know of a person who has diligently sought God who has never found him. He has revealed himself in scripture, his word. He has revealed himself in the universe, the material world. Psalm 19, that beautiful design psalm says that the heavens declare the glory of God, the firmament show forth his handiwork. From the Christian perspective, he has revealed himself ultimately in Jesus. Let me say to you that when you look at verse 1, as I wrap up quickly, it is quite clear, brothers and sisters, that Dorcas was not an ordinary woman. You know, we have a lot of ordinary women throughout the length and breadth of Barbados. Their names may never be called in certain forums. They may never be privy to get a national award. But these women, men too, but we're dealing with the women today. These women continue to do incredible tasks every single day. So Dorcas was not an ordinary woman. In fact, that verse 1 suggests that she was a disciple of Jesus. And I believe with all my heart that her benevolence, her acts of charity, the openness of her heart to others, sharing of her limited resources with others, were indeed shaped by the teachings of Jesus, were indeed shaped by the pattern that Jesus himself set. And I trust today that even as we reflect in this service and we observe the life of Dorcas and the life of Hortense, that we too would ask God to help us to be available to him. And availability to God is not just about some theoretical exercise or demonstrating it by way of worship and things like that that we need to do in the assembly. That has its place. But availability to Christ must translate in very practical engagements, in touching lives where it matters most, in enacting what Jesus said when he went into the temple, when he took up the book and read from the prophets. When the prophet said of him that he's come to open the eyes of those who are blind, to cause those who are deaf to hear, to declare the acceptable word of God, he closed the book and then he said, this day what you hear is fulfilled in me. I am the one of whom the prophet spoke. Let us therefore go forth today to serve and serve with confidence. Let us serve with the understanding that when our task here on earth is ended, if we remain faithful, we too will hear those words of commendation, well done, good and faithful servant. Thou hast been faithful over a few things, I will make thee ruler over many things. Enter thou into the joy of the world, the Lord. And so I encourage you to be steadfast, to be unmovable, and to always abound in the work of the Lord. For as much as you know, your labor is not in vain in the Lord. This is the word of God. Let us pray. Just take a minute for quiet reflection, and then we will pray. Father, we thank you for your word. Thank you that we can follow your example. You gave of yourself, you gave of your son. Your son gave of his life so that we might have life. Despite the challenges of the times in which we live, we pray, God, that you would empower us, give us a broad vision. And help, O God, that we would share of our time and we would share of our resources so that others may be helped. Hear and answer our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Let us stand and affirm our commitment to the Christian faith in the words of the stand. Together, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Again, on the behalf of the family, we want to thank all of you for coming. Thanks for taking time out of your busy schedules to identify with the family in this their time of grief. Please remember them in the weeks and months ahead. Shall we bow for the benediction? Then we'll have the recessional hymn, "To God Be the Glory." May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord cause his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon you and grant you his peace, both now and forever. Amen. The recessional hymn, "To God Be the Glory, Great Things He Hath Done. So loved he the world that he gave us his Son, who yielded his life an atonement for sin and opened the life gate that all may go in. To God be the glory. So loved he the world that he gave us his Son.